Let's first make a start on the big story here. We're getting in breaking inputs here. Latest hearing, which is currently underway in the Rajasthan High Court, that had taken up the Rebel Congress MLA's plea, which was challenging the speaker's disqualifying the Rebel disqualification notice, in fact, a hearing of which that has been on. Abhishek Manu Singhvi, who's representing the Congress, saying that a petition challenging the show cause notice issued by a speaker is premature. He's also here added that the Rebel Congress MLAs can raise their contentions before the speaker himself instead of going to court. Remember, Abhishek Manu Singhvi here is representing the Congress Rajasthan government in these arguments here. We have with us our deputy news editor, Meenakshi, getting us those inputs. Ongoing hearing, we've already heard from the other side earlier in the day today. This is from the government side now. Meenakshi, please go ahead.
Well, Dr. Singhvi was representing the speaker's interests, and in the High Court division bench of the High Court, he yesterday argued as to how the court cannot interfere with the notice issued by the speaker. Because remember, what happened on an earlier occasion, while Mr. Salvi and Mukul Rohtagi argued for Sachin Pilot and the 18 MLAs, they also sought for a stay on the speaker's notice. So it was Dr. Singhvi's contention that the petition challenging the show cause notice, which has been issued by the speaker, is premature. And all the objections and the contentions that Sachin Pilot and the 18 MLAs have currently, those contentions can also be agitated and raised before the speaker in their respective responses. However, as we have showcased to our viewers at 12 in the afternoon today, that this is going to be a detailed matter which will see a lot of twists and turns and detailed arguments and submissions being made by eminent senior counsels. Therefore, the Rajasthan High Court today has adjourned, or rather deferred, the hearing to Monday at 10 a.m., which is the 20th of July. But the interesting thing here, Seher, is that the speaker also has been directed to not take any decision on the disqualification notices till 5:30 p.m. Tuesday, which is the 21st of July. So this means that the High Court is in all minds to conclude or dispose of the issue in one way or the other by the 21st of July, Tuesday.
Right. So, Meenakshi, effectively, this is already having instructed the speaker from arguments that we've heard in court, saying that this is in the speaker's jurisdiction, the disqualification notice, and for him to decide what to do next here. But this is now already interfered upon by the High Court, when the High Court today says even stops the speaker from taking any further decision, giving more time to the Rebel Congress MLAs, given more time to this hearing, which is currently away, up to Tuesday.
I mean, it was pretty well laid out ahead yesterday when they were knocking on the doors of the High Court. Even at that time, it was pretty much understood, because this is a matter which is now under the purview of judicial review. It is being agitated legally. Therefore, during the pendency of the matter, it was understood that perhaps either the High Court would permit for the speaker to proceed, or the High Court would not permit for the speaker to proceed for a brief period of time. So we had showcased to our viewers how this was essentially time-buying tactics by Sachin Pilot and the 18 MLAs to keep trying to build their capital within the party, to keep trying to perhaps push their point across. And therefore, the D-Day of today, where they had to file their responses, now gets extended by the weekend, which is Saturday, Sunday, 2 days, plus Monday and Tuesday. So effectively 72 hours, which is 3 days' time, effectively they have bought for themselves to really make up their mind, mull over their future course of action, and also mull over their responses to the speaker's notice. So yes, this is pretty much along expected lines, part of political strategy playing out legally before the Rajasthan High Court.
Mm-hmm. Right. Meenakshi, thanks for getting us that update. Well, because of the current financial strain, the Madras High Court has now ordered private schools and colleges across the state of Tamil Nadu to collect 40% fees before the 31st of August and 35% more by the month of October. So this is fees that can be given in installments, keeping in mind the interest of the students here who are not in a position to purchase books. The High Court here directing the Tamil Nadu government to consider providing books, textbooks free of cost this year of private schools as well. So this is an instruction not just for the government schools. This is something that private schools and colleges will need to now follow as well. Well, the state of Maharashtra continues to be a stress point for COVID-19 with one of the largest numbers that the state has seen across the country. Moving on beyond Bombay, having managed to flatten the curve and successfully claim the Dharavi challenge here, we are now looking at areas around Bombay, Mumbai. Satellite towns in Mumbai now are emerging as new hotspot areas. This is the Mumbai metropolitan region. It includes all of these satellite towns which are near Mumbai. They're suffering from poor testing. There are no laboratories available in the area, no private laboratories. There is a lack of medical infrastructure, and authorities now only now waking up in racing against time for preparedness on ground. Remember, it is already too late, but let's get in some specific details here in the importance of this area, the significance to be reining in those numbers now in areas around Mumbai. We have with us Avni Raja getting us those inputs here. Yes, Avni, please go ahead.
Well, that's right, Seher. Now, these satellite towns, the Mumbai metropolitan region, have clearly been completely ignored, neglected. All the focus has been on Mumbai up until now. And of course, you have areas such as Dharavi, where we've seen a successful battle against COVID, and Dharavi emerging victorious on that front is what it seems right now. And in all of that, these towns have gotten ignored. And these towns are extremely important, especially when it comes to the city of Mumbai, because these towns have India's largest industrialized belt. So you've got a 1.6 crore population in three districts that we're talking about. It houses IT manufacturing hubs. Several key industrial units are in this entire belt here. It's also a preferred destination as far as migrants are concerned, migrant workers are concerned. It provides a large number of workforce to Mumbai. So a lot of the workforce who comes to Mumbai to work here lives in this entire area. So 40% of the population there actually traveling to Mumbai. So that's really the significance here. And it's also important to mention that while, we are happy about the fact that Mumbai is sort of settling down as far as COVID is concerned, but these towns, when we see this kind of a surge there, it obviously could be only a matter of time before we see these cases come back into Mumbai once again. So it's extremely important. And there is such a large population there as well. So it's extremely important on both fronts to sort of ensure that the situation is brought back under control, Seher.
That's true. This is a concern not just for the places, the satellite towns, but also if there is continuous movement. Remember, from satellite towns to main Mumbai, there is continuous movement here of the population. It could once again lead to a spike in cases in Mumbai as well. Avni, thank you for getting us those inputs. One of these satellite towns, these areas near Mumbai, is Panvel. Now, what we have here is that there are no beds available to administer another patient here. The city is facing a massive crunch in infrastructure, government hospitals that have only 450 beds. And in order to meet the rising demand now, the government has taken over 600 beds from private hospitals there, which are all occupied already. But despite this uphill challenge, Panvel civic body chief here says the situation is now under control because of the lockdown.
Not only 1,000 but 1,500 cases are there in last 10 days. Mm-hmm. But I deny that this is becoming the hot spot, because there are the cases around 200 near about 10 to 15 days back. And due to lockdown, these figures are stagnant or little reduced than the daily figures which were coming before that day. And currently we are seeing that figures daily around 125 to 150 50 patients are there, and the figure is slightly increasing. If we go through figures from all other corporations in MMR section, There is also the similar situation, or some higher figures are coming from there. But Panvel has tried to control it, and it is under control now.
You are saying Panvel has tried to control it. You are also saying that 125 to 150 cases are being seen on a daily basis. How are we exactly controlling it, if you can tell us?
Basically, increase was from 50 to 200. And now, since last 10 to 15 days, we are stagnant or reducing. Because the graph of increase we have seen worldwide. Like that, there is no the graph of increasing graph. The figure is stagnant and slightly reducing there. Panvel is the city which is developed by SIDCO, and most of the working people are living in Panvel area. They are working in MMR section or somewhere else, or some industrial area. They are getting infected at their workplace, as well as they are being infected during their transit or transportation. And hence, if we go through all figures from Panvel, we will see there is no cluster. There is no containment zone where we have figure of 50 or more. Figure is that in single building there are 2, 4 like these patients.
Our correspondent Neha is getting us further inputs here after this conversation with the Panvel commissioner here. She's currently at Kharghar, which is in Navi Mumbai. Neha, apart from the assurance that now beds availability is there, but that's not all that is required. There are still laboratory testing, which is not up to the mark. ICUs, ventilators, all of that, that needs to be discussed here as well.
In fact, sir, when we spoke to Panvel commissioner, he admitted to the fact that there is stress being caused because the ventilators are not being able to match up to the rising cases. As he was saying that how there is a daily increase in 125, 150 cases every
yes.
day. This was not the scenario in Panvel about a couple of months back. But now that this is happening, the stress is increasing. They are facing increasing difficulties to provide oxygenated beds, give ICU beds and also ventilators. And they are increasingly struggling to match up to this number. In fact, the commissioner was also telling us how on an everyday basis they are trying to tap more and more private hospitals so that beds could be arranged for locals. And when we were in Panvel, when Miranau spoke to a lot of locals, we also got case studies of how people were complaining that getting a bed is taking at least 6 to 7 hours of time. They have to go from hospital to hospital. So this is remaining, this is a challenge as far as getting health infrastructure is concerned for an area in Mumbai metropolitan region that could have got these facilities in the past 3 months, but failed to do so.
Neha, very quickly also help us understand here for our viewers not familiar with satellite towns of Mumbai, population density. Mumbai is a city, of course, which has successfully managed flattening the curve in Dharavi, which was the biggest scare that the country had seen. Is it going to be as much a challenge here in these towns here as well?
Absolutely, it is a challenge, and it is the time now that the state government apply the aggressive testing, aggressive screening formula, and give the required healthcare facilities in these corporations as well. Because the Miranau's relentless campaign in these areas have shown that how the areas have woken up now to the situation, are now realizing that more and more labs are needed for testing, and are now deciding that they cannot be dependent on Mumbai's labs as far as testing is concerned. It is now that facilities of quarantine centers or getting more oxygenated beds is being talked about after 3 months of wait, when the other corporations have already received it. In fact, in these areas, second lockdown has been called in most of the corporations, and even in that, violations could be seen in many containment zones and areas. And the area which we are talking about, Seher, is Mumbai metropolitan region. This is an area which sees about half of the population as far as the entire Maharashtra belt is concerned, and as far as corona cases are concerned. This is an area which is an industrial belt. People from this area travel to Mumbai for their work purpose, for other specific reasons. And this area specifically has not received so much of help and health infrastructure, and which is why it has remained a challenge to get hold of the corona cases, to ensure that these cases come down in these areas specifically.
Right. Absolutely. Neha, thank you for getting us those inputs. This is a specific case in point that has been reported by a Mumbai team. This is regarding Suraj Suryavanshi, who is a labourer in Panvel. He shared with us his harrowing experience here of hunting for a hospital bed for his mother. Now, his mother was experiencing breathlessness. She was showing COVID symptoms but hadn't been tested. She desperately required hospitalization. But three hospitals in Panvel that refused admission, saying that this is a suspected COVID case, and they did not have an ICU to admit her and treat her. Finally, he managed to take his ailing mother here to travel the extra mile, get admitted in Navi Mumbai instead.
मैं मतलब उस दिन मैं गया एमजेएम में गया पहला स्टार्टिंग 7 बजे तकलीफ होने लगा तो एमजेएम में लेके गए एमजेएम वाले ना बोले फिर मैंने सत्यम में भी देखा सत्यम में भी वो बोले हमारे पास अभी चालू नहीं हुआ 3 दिन लगेगा तो उसके बाद मैं प्राइवेट में भी देखा नहीं हुआ तो मैं माताड़ी हमारा हॉस्पिटल है उधर लेके गया उधर भी बेड के लिए ना बोला मुझे तो मैं एनएमसी हॉस्पिटल है उधर मुझे दिया रात को 1 बजे तक
तो पनवेल में ये पनवेल के अंदर वाले कोई अस्पताल में आपको मिला या नहीं मिला
नहीं मिला
कितनी तकलीफ हुई आपको
ये तभी तो 7 बजे से मिले कि रात को 1 बजे तक घूम रहा था तभी तक तो मुझे नहीं मिला इधर भी
अस्पताल वाले क्या बता रहे थे क्यों नहीं दे रहे हैं
उनको आईसीयू मांगता है आईसीयू खाली नहीं है बोल रहे थे सब बाजू और प्राइवेट में जा रहा तो प्राइवेट वाले भी ना बोल रहे थे क्योंकि सांस लेने में तकलीफ हो रहा था इसलिए वो लोग बोल रहे थे कोविड है हम नहीं लेंगे
में क्या जितने लोग कांग्रेस से टूट के गए बीजेपी का षड्यंत्र था क्या अपने झगड़े को अपनी लड़ाई को बीजेपी के माथे पर मढ़ना और जिस तरीके से राजस्थान में भय का वातावरण तैयार किया जनप्रतिनिधियों के बीच में छोटे दलों के बीच में निर्दलियों के बीच में उनकी अपनी हैसियत होती है उनका अपना स्वतंत्र विचार है जिस तरीके के बीटीपी के लोगों के साथ में वीडियो आप सबने देखे मैं दोहराना नहीं चाह रहा वो क्या था उनको अपने निर्वाचन क्षेत्र में जाने के दौरान उनकी गाड़ी की चाबी छीन ली क्या ये हनन नहीं था विशेषाधिकार का वो हाईवे किंग में 4 घंटे तक बंधक बनाए गए कांग्रेस पार्टी के सरकार के 2 मंत्रियों के द्वारा ये कांग्रेस के शासन की सीधी सीधी सी बानगीर याद दिलाती आपातकाल की जिसके खुद गवाह अशोक गहलोत जी 124A अंग्रेजों का कानून उस अंग्रेजों के कानून को जिसकी पैरोकारी 2019 में हटाने के लिए खुद की पार्टी ने की और दर्द हुआ उनको जब कन्हैया कुमार और हार्दिक पटेल पर लगा आज उस 124A की आड़ में और जिस तरीके से मुकदमे दर्ज कर कर डराने और धमकाने का और भयभीत करने की कोशिश हुई है मुझे लगता है कुर्सी जाने का भय का इससे बड़ा कोई एविडेंस नहीं हो सकता दूसरा मुझे ऐतराज है रणदीप सुरजेवाला जी एसओजी के डीजी हैं क्या जो भाषा इस्तेमाल की सोर्स क्या है उसका क्या जांच हो गई थी इस तरीके की बनावटी बातों से हमारी पार्टी के नेताओं पर तो कम से कम लांछित नहीं करें संजय जैन का जिक्र आया उसको अपराधी एस्टेब्लिश किया पकड़ा होगा लेकिन संजय जैन भारतीय जनता पार्टी का कोई नेता नहीं है और चौंकाने वाली बात यह है कि वो कांग्रेस पार्टी का लूणकरण सर का ब्लॉक अध्यक्ष रहा है कांग्रेस के नेताओं का शागिर्द है वो राजनीतिक हलकों में घूमता होगा लेकिन मुझे लगता है कि कहीं संजय जैन को भी प्रायोजित तरीके से बीजेपी के नेताओं को बदनाम करने के लिए तो नहीं लगाया गया पूरा फ्रेम किया ड्रामा इस बात पर भी ऐतराज है कि संजय जैन का स्टेटस तय करें हो और इस बात से साफ नजर आता है कि अशोक गहलोत जी कुर्सी बचाने के लिए इतने विचलित हैं इतने असंतुलित हैं कि वो प्रतिशोध की राजनीति पर उतर आए ये हताशा पुत्र की हार भी हो सकती है ये हताशा इनकम टैक्स के छापे भी हो सकते हैं लेकिन मुझे लगता है इस बात का जवाब राजस्थान की जनता मांगती है कि राजस्थान की सरकार को बाड़े से कितने दिन चलाओगे 500 से ज्यादा मौतें हो गई आज भी 800 का आंकड़ा है 6000 से ऊपर केसेज हो गए उन मंत्रियों को और विधायकों को वहां की जनता ढूंढ रही है और वहां की सरकार उस बाड़े में फुटबॉल खेल रही है, इसका जवाब तो जनता जरूर मांगेगी। आपको हक है, आपकी सरकार है, लेकिन मुझे लगता है ये हक तो कतई नहीं है। इसका जवाब हम मांगते हैं राजस्थान की जनता की तरफ से कि कृपया ये स्पष्ट करें कि बाड़े से कितने दिन सरकार चलेगी। कोरोना का कहीं जिक्र नहीं है, एक लफ्ज भी कभी कहो कोई रिलीफ के काम का। इसलिए मेरा सख्त ऐतराज है कि जिस तरीके से गजेंद्र सिंह जी पर आरोप लगाए और झूठा इस तरीके से प्रचारित किया गया, एक किस्म से ये मानहानि है। उन्होंने स्पष्ट कर दिया खुद ने, और संजय जैन की आड़ में जिस तरीके से उनको बीजेपी का नेता साबित करने की कोशिश हुई है, मेरा ऐतराज है। मैं एक जिम्मेवार पार्टी के अध्यक्ष के नाते कह सकता हूं कि पार्टी का कोई पदाधिकारी नहीं, कोई हैसियत नहीं। मैं चाहूंगा कि जो प्रमुख दो बातें थी जिस पर मुझे ऐतराज था, जो मैंने सुना, लेकिन तकनीकी तौर पर भी और कुछ और बातें हमारे माननीय नेता प्रतिपक्ष आपके बीच में रखेंगे।
मैं आपसे कुछ शब्दों में अपनी बात कहना चाह रहा हूं। वास्तव में ये प्रमाणित सत्य है कि झगड़ा इनके आपस का है, और इन्होंने इस झगड़े को प्रारंभ से भारतीय जनता पार्टी पर डालने का खूब प्रयत्न किया है, राज्यसभा के समय में भी और आज के समय में भी। आपने देखा होगा एसओजी से दो लोगों को पकड़ा गया था, और इनको भारतीय जनता पार्टी से जुड़े हुए लोग कहा गया, उनके बारे में पूछताछ भी हो गई, वो जेसी भी हो गए। एसओजी ने क्या तथ्य इकट्ठे किए इसके बारे में अगर आप कुछ आगे बढ़ना चाहते हो तो बताओ कि बीजेपी का इन्वॉल्वमेंट कहाँ है कहाँ नहीं है। तो मेरे उस क्षेत्र में अशोक सिंह जी के बारे में बताते हैं, मेतवाला बांसवाड़ा जिले के कहीं रहने वाले। मैं 40 साल से उस जिले की बैठकों में जाता हूँ, जब 12 लोगों की बैठक करता था तब भी और आज भी। मैंने मेरी जिले की बैठक में कभी अशोक सिंह जी को नहीं देखा। कोई बड़ा लीडर आ जाता हो और कहीं मंच पे आ जाते हैं और फोटो खींचा लेते हैं तो मैं नहीं कह सकता बीजेपी का इन्वॉल्वमेंट, लेकिन उसमें भी बीजेपी को रगड़ने की कोशिश की। जब एसओ जी आपके पास है, जांच आप कर रहे हो, इतने दिन हो गया, आपने उससे पूछताछ कर ली और उसको जेसी कर दिया, अगर कोई तथ्य मिले तो बताओ ना। वैसा का वैसा सेम ड्रामा गजेंद्र सिंह जी को जोड़ करके बीजेपी को जोड़ने का एक तरह से दुस्साहस किया है। ये प्रमाणित है कि झगड़ा आपके आपस का है और इस सीमा तक चला गया कि एक दूसरे ने एक दूसरे के खिलाफ तलवारें खींच करके इतने हल्के शब्दों का प्रयोग किया, जिनके साथ वर्षों तक काम किया और जिन्होंने आप लोगों ने बड़े संगठन की दुआएं दी थी, आज वो आदमी इतना निकृष्ट हो गया तो इतने दिन तक क्या कर रहे थे? केवल और केवल स्वार्थ पे चोट पड़ती तब इस बात को करते हैं। गजेंद्र सिंह जी के बारे में पहली बात मैं आपको कहता हूँ, कोई भी आप में से कोई भी मेरा वीडियो क्लिक कर दें और आप मेरे खिलाफ केस दर्ज करा दें, संभव है? अगर कोई पुलिस डिपार्टमेंट की परमिशन के आधार पर कोई टेपिंग नहीं हो सकता, बिना होम डिपार्टमेंट की पूर्व स्वीकृति के किसी भी व्यक्ति का फोन टैपिंग नहीं हो सकता, उसके लिए अधिकृत रूप से फाइल चला करके परमिशन लेने के बाद फिर टैपिंग होता है, वो अधिकृत टैपिंग होता है।
Is our breaking inputs, the Rajasthan BJP unit in this press conference is questioning the authenticity of the tapes here, saying that this is a desperate measure, a big sign of fear of the Rajasthan chief minister, fear of losing the chief minister's chair, saying that there is no authenticity to these audio tapes here, and they are challenging the tapes which had alleged that the BJP was trying to break into the Congress government. With that, we're slipping into a breather. News and updates, more in just a bit.